The topic of our new channel is financing the 21st century, development of investment banking and capital markets. Our moderator is Mr. Hasan Jafri, advisor to the board Ünlü&Co, managing director HJ Advisory PTE from Singapore. Please, I would like to invite you to the stage, Mr. Jafri. And the panelists are Mr. Yaseen, Anwar, senior advisor, ICBC Singapore, former governor, State Bank of Pakistan, Şule Kılıç, Ms. Şule Kılıç, deputy head, EBRD, infrastructure, energy and NR from Turkey, Nick Moakes, chief investment officer, Wellcome Trust, and Paul Smith, global president and CEO, CFA Institute from United States. Thank you.
Okay.
And then I. Can you hear me? Good morning, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hasan Jafri. I am an advisor to Turkey's leading investment bank, Ünlü&Co. I'll be the moderator for today's session. There's a fair bit to cover, and I know we're in between lunch and this session, so we'd like to keep it quite tight. I'll begin with laying out first the key issues that we're going to be discussing in this panel. As we know, Turkey is at a crossroads. For more than a decade, economic growth has been strong, and Turkey has emerged as a leading emerging markets country. And Turkey's ambitions are bigger, to become one of the top 10 economies in the world by 2023. To get there, one of the key issues that Turkey has to deal with is the depth of its capital markets and the development of the capital markets. Already, Turkey has a good, strong foundation. It has active currency, bond, and equity markets, and a burgeoning Islamic finance market. What would be even better is for the investment banking and merchant banking business to also expand. In this context, we have the pleasure of inviting, of hosting this panel. We'll begin the discussion with Mr. Mahmoud Ünlü, who's the founder and chairman of Ünlü&Co. Ünlü is a leading investment bank. It has brought in close to $2 billion worth of investments into Turkey, so it's a topic that's very dear to their hearts. Once Mahmoud Bey has finished his opening remarks, we'll move on to the panel. May I please invite Mahmoud Bey to come and deliver his remarks. Thank you.
That's 3 minutes. Kıymetli konuklar, değerli basın mensupları, öncelikle hepinize hoş geldiniz demek istiyorum. Bu yıl 8.'si yapılan Boğaziçi Zirvesi'nin bir parçası olduğumuz için çok mutluyuz. 3 gün sürecek olan bu zirvede bankacılık ve finansın yanı sıra birçok konuda kıymetli katılımcılarla toplantılar düzenleniyor ve bunun da İstanbul'da yapılıyor olması bize de ayrıca gurur veriyor. Organizasyon komitesine de bu vesileyle teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Biraz sonra Hasan'ın bahsettiği panel başlayacak. Uluslararası çok kıymetli konuşmacıları bir araya getirdik. Onlar hem Türkiye'de hem dünyadaki yatırım bankacılığı ve sermaye piyasalarının gelişimi ve bunların gelişmekte olan ülkelere etkilerini ve faydalarını tartışacaklar. Türkiye'de de aynı zamanda tabii alternatif kaynak yaratımı da önemli bir konu. Türkiye'de şirketlere yeni kaynak dan bahsettiğimiz zaman çoğunlukla aklımıza ilk gelen ticari bankaların kredileri oluyor. Kaynak ihtiyaçlarını şirketler bu şekilde gideriyorlar. Halbuki Türkiye'de de birçok alternatif kaynak mevcut. yatırım bankaları ve sermaye piyasaları kanalıyla ulaşabilecek kaynaklar mevcut. Halka arzlar, tahvil ihraçları, convertible'lar, private equity'ler, şirketler, ortaklıklar gibi. Ancak halen yatırım bankacılığı ve sermaye piyasaları emekleme aşamalarını yeni yeni aşıyorlar. Bu piyasaların gelişmesiyle beraber Türkiye'deki büyüme de daha sürdürülebilir ve yüksek seviyede seyredeceğine inanıyoruz. Bunda sermaye piyasalarının gelişmesindeki en önemli aktörler yatırım bankaları ve varlık yönetim şirketleri. Biz Ünlü&Co olarak 22 yıldır bu alanlarda faaliyet gösteriyoruz. Son 5 yılda Türkiye'ye 10 milyar dolardan fazla sermaye ve 5 milyar dolar ilave kaynak sağladık. Amacımız ve hedefimiz piyasada yatırım bankalarının artması, bu vesileyle de sermaye piyasalarının derinlik kazanması ve alternatif yatırım araçlarının buralarda işlem görebilmeleri. Bununla ilgili hala bir takım düzenlemelere ihtiyaç var, daha rekabetçi ortamın oluşabilmesi için, ama bu yönde ilerlemeler de görüyoruz. Şimdi daha fazla konuşup sizin zamanınızı almadan, burada bu kadar tecrübeli uluslararası konuşmamızı toplamışken sözü onlara bırakmak istiyorum. Hepinize tekrar geldiğiniz için teşekkür ediyorum.
Excellent. Thank you, Mehmet. That was quite helpful and illuminating. Before we get into the panel, let me just quickly walk you through how we're going to do this. We have a really very informative session ahead of us. We have four people who bring global perspectives as well as a lot of local depth, and have quite a bit to share with us. So we'll begin the session with opening remarks by the four panelists. Before then, following that, we will get into a discussion on a few of the key issues. Let me first start that session with Mr. Nick Moakes. Nick is the Chief Investment Officer for Ünlü&Co for Wellcome Trust, based in the UK. They are one of the leading global investors, long-term investors, and they are also quite active in Turkey. Nick will provide a bit of color on what is happening in terms of the development of capital markets globally, as well as his own views on how Turkey can learn from it. Would you like to proceed? Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Hasan, and good afternoon, everybody. It is now afternoon, yes. So, from a long-term investor perspective, firstly, what do I mean by long-term investor? It's very simple. A long-term investor gets into an investment without a time frame where they see the need to sell that investment. As the Wellcome Trust, we're a global charitable endowment. We have a portfolio of about $31.5 billion as of today. And we're spending about $1.5 billion a year funding medical research, which is the reason for our existence. We have no other source of income but the return that we generate on our portfolio. So for us, investing in places where we see a long growth runway is really important. And that's why we're excited about markets like Turkey, where there's a demographic tailwind and where there is a structural shift towards these economies. We have, at the moment, of the order of about $250 million invested in Turkey in a variety of different avenues. I'll come on to that later. First of all, let me just give you a bit of background about how I see the financial landscape globally. Global financial crisis has changed the attitude, as we all know, of governments and of regulators towards their financial systems. Before 2008, it was assumed that banks and financial institutions would self-regulate to a large extent and that they would be sensible. I'm afraid that large global banks, in fact, banks in many countries, have a tendency towards excess if you allow them to. And there's a pendulum that over history has swung between a laissez-faire attitude and a highly regulated attitude towards banks. And today, globally, we're very much heading towards that highly regulated end of the pendulum. To give you an example of that, in terms of capital requirements that banks have to hold, there's been a double whammy. On the one hand, those levels are now much, much higher than they were before the crisis. A typical global bank would now be looking at holding 12, 13% capital, whereas pre-crisis, that would have been a 5 or 6%. More importantly, the risk weighting that you have to apply to assets has also been significantly tightened up, which means that the effective capital has probably increased fourfold for global banks. Now, there will come a point in the future where politicians and regulators will say, why aren't banks lending more in our economy? Well, the answer is because you're not allowing them to, because they're having to hold so much capital. But right now, today, that's where we are globally. And that means that there is an increasingly important place for non-lending institutions, if I can put it in those terms. Investment banks is good shorthand for that, but actually many investment banks are also lenders. So alternative sources of finance. If you look at emerging markets, many emerging markets have not had the same change in regulatory regimes. Regulation has tightened a bit, but it was already tighter before the financial crisis. Interestingly though, banks in emerging markets often do not lend as much as you might think into the local economy. Often these economies are underbanked. One reason is, and take the example of Turkey, where you have high returns from investing in sovereign debt, there is no incentive for banks to lend to commercial enterprises. And that's why it's even more important in a market like Turkey, or in many other emerging markets, Brazil would be another classic example, that you have alternatives, that you have an investment banking landscape which enables debt financing through bonds, that enables equity financing, because the bank financing is simply not there. Actually, the landscape is shifting a bit more that way in developed markets as well. You're seeing explicit regulatory support for banks which are, if you like, challenger banks doing alternative things. For us, when we look at Turkey as an investment destination, first thing to say is that we have a small centralized investment team in London. We needed a local partner. We looked at various different alternatives, and actually we've chosen Ünlü&Co as our main partner in Turkey. And the main reason for that is that we are essentially equity investors. We're much more interested in the long-term returns from holding equity than a shorter-term flip, if you like. And we needed a partner that understood that. And frankly, going to a bank, a mainstream bank, that doesn't have the same involvement with equity markets, that's more interested in holding sovereign debt, was kind of not for us. And that's why we've ended up partnering with a local investment bank in addition to making direct investments ourselves. I will stop there, but I think just the strap line here is the regulatory environment globally is getting tighter and will continue to tighten for the foreseeable future. And that means that alternative methods of raising money are really crucial if you're going to have a vibrant economy.
Excellent, Nick. Thank you very much. And it's a great segue to our next panelist. Governor Yaseen Anwar is very familiar with Turkey. Governor Anwar is advisor to the Chinese bank ICBC, and prior to that, he was the governor of the State Bank of Pakistan. He is quite well informed on global issues, some of which Nick just mentioned. May I please give the floor to Governor Anwar?
Thank you, Hasan. Thank you very much for inviting me as well. To start off, I must thank Nick for criticizing me as a former central banker in terms of what we did. And I can't disagree with him. Having served on the Financial Stability Board, the 2008, and I'll touch on that, crisis did in fact create problems that we've all faced even today with sluggish growth, aggregate demand, although it's up in the United States right now, but created problems there. And then we had the existential sovereign debt crisis in the European market, which led to negative interest rates. So divergent monetary policies for the two regions was obviously a major flaw that that is being corrected with quantitative easing and other measures, with growth picking up in each country. Let me touch on quickly two areas which are really relevant for the future growth of the economy: is monetary policy by central banks, and as well as the macroprudential regulations that Nick so eloquently talked about, and how it's squeezed the banks' balance sheets. What it has done is long-term assets are discouraged as a result of that, and short-term orientation to the banks has taken place. Thus, the world has become a more transactional-oriented world. We need to shift that. And I've recommended many times to various central bank governors that we must change those regulations. I'll touch on that later on. But let me quickly touch on the current global landscape. 2017 was quite an interesting year. It started off with Donald Trump's election and his first America First mantra, which is tantamount to saying isolationist and protectionist measures. At the end of the year, last month, was the 19th National Party Congress in China, where President Xi Jinping announced the opposite, i.e. the globalization philosophy of his, backed by his Belt Road Initiative of $2.8 trillion or so forth, that comprises of 65 countries with 65% of the world's population and significant part of the global GDP. So these divergent plans are obviously going to change the entire global landscape that we have today and going forward. How many countries will shift their gears? Well, my own philosophy has always been that protectionist measures are not an effort for globalization. Globalization is here to stay, and trade represents the backbone of any global economy. We go back to history. In the 1930s, the Smoot-Hawley tariff by the United States that was enacted led to a 64% reduction in global trade. We don't want to go back to that particular path again. So how are we going to shift gears in terms of stimulating the global economy? We have talked about China. Everybody's talked about China. Asia represents the growth model because growth rates of excess of 5% are there in that area. China, with its 6.5%, represents still three times greater growth rates than the United States. If you look at 1980 to 2016, the global economy, a global growth rate, was 3.7%. If you take out, strip out China out of that equation, it comes down to 2.5%. That gives you an idea how, over the last few decades, China has become a very formidable animal. Now, this BRI initiative, and I'll talk about that a little later on also, focuses on infrastructure. And infrastructure is the engine of growth that we all need to stimulate, along with the regulatory framework, which I'll talk about later on. But some soothsayers have said there's $8 trillion a gap. McKinsey has come out with $50 trillion by 2050. The ASEAN countries are urbanized less than 45%. Pakistan is less than 40. But the international standard is 60%. And up by 2040-50, it's expected the ASEAN countries will reach that level. Where are the resources for this gap of $8 trillion and $50 trillion? That's where the BRI initiative comes in, along with the multilaterals, with AIIB, EBRD, ADB, World Bank, et cetera, and alternative sources of financing. There's talk about $50 billion of private equity money that is available, according to studies, but only $1 billion has been allocated thus far. Why? Because most of the projects are not bankable, along with the regulatory issues. So how do we go about going forward in this? And that's where we need to have regulatory changes. And I've talked about this before, how the long-term assets need to be restored in the balance sheet, so add value to the shareholders long term. The macroprudential regulations for Basel III need to be amended, particularly where it comes to infrastructure and where there's co-financing opportunities available multilaterals. So these kinds of efforts need to be undertaken, and the central banks, I can tell you, Financial Stability Board is looking at it as we speak. So the infrastructure application is the key to this whole shift in our stimulating the global economy. I won't go into this in any more detail because I think my time is very short. So I'll cut it off here, and we can perhaps have a discussion on how infrastructure can represent the opportunity for capital markets products and the Turkish banks.
Thank you very much. That was quite helpful. I now would like to invite Şule to talk a little bit about the Turkish experience in EBRD. Now, Turkey is a very critical part of EBRD's global investment portfolio. In fact, it is the largest single country exposure that EBRD has. And therefore, it is in the interest of EBRD also to deepen the capital markets in the country, of which they have, in fact, been working on quite a fair bit. Şule, would you like to share what EBRD has been doing in that front?
Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Hasan. I'd like to, first of all, thank you very much to organizers for this very exceptional event, and thanks for inviting me. Very briefly on EBRD, it is a multilateral organization which is actually supranational. Shareholders are the countries, and we are our board of directors are made up of representatives from each of the country appointed by the relevant ministries. And our aim is to support the development of the countries and to support them in their transitional development process. And from that point of view, Turkey is a very important country. Why? On the one side, compared with the 37 other countries where EBRD is active, which includes North Africa, Central Asia, Central and Eastern Europe, and South Eastern Europe, and including Ukraine and Turkey. Turkey, on the one side, appears as if more developed country compared with those economies which EBRD is active. But on the other side, Turkey is a growing economy, and still there are a lot of transitional changes need to be done in order the country to complete its development phase. So from that point of view, it has certain size. And in terms of size, I need to say Turkey is one of the largest countries which EBRD is operating. And but also in terms of intelligence and knowledge basis of the country. That's why until now Turkey acted as a role model for our other country of operations. As of today, operations started in 2009, and as of today, we have 9.5 billion euro investment made in Turkey. And last year, it was 1.9 billion euro, and this year, probably, we will be 1.5, 1.6 billion euro on top coming on it. And in terms of sectors, we have a very well diversification, and one third only goes to infrastructure and energy. And I fully agree with our speaker here, is that infrastructure is key in order to support the development of the country. That's why it is one of the key areas for EBRD's activities in Turkey. Another very important area to support the development is development and deepening of the capital markets. Why? I mean, when you look at the pipeline of Turkey, only for infrastructure, we are talking $100 billion of dollars to be invested in the country, and it has been already a very busy pipeline, and each of the projects which we were talking, like a multi-billion dollar project, look at all the transportation projects, look at the hospital PPP projects. And when you put all this together, I mean, to finance all these projects only with a simple, straightforward project financing from the banks, impossible. Because why? I mean, one of the things you need is you should try to extend the tenor as much as you can. And I mean, thanks to our Turkish banks, and they are really very good followers, and they have really very good liquidity, which they are supporting the infrastructure development. But still, I mean, we are talking a couple of $100 billion to be invested on the infrastructure in Turkey. So these sources will be this way or that way will exhaust. And we as a multilateral can only help and support and be anchor or investor in a way to demonstrate to other investors to come to this market. And one of the, of course, biggest problems we have is Basel III, which is stopping quite a number of international banks to support this. So when we put all this together, there is no other choice but to support the development of the capital markets, which is going to be the probably the solution to finance all these large investments to be made in the country. That's why out of our Turkey country strategy for 2015-2019, deepening of the capital markets has been chosen as one of the very key themes of EBRD for Turkey. And not only on the equity side, but also on the debt side, we are trying to be anchor investors. Maybe you know already our investment, equity investment in Borsa Istanbul, exactly for this purpose, to support the equity capital markets. We become shareholder to Borsa Istanbul. And on the debt side, we have developed a program and a 700 million TL program to act as an anchor investor in the TL bond capital markets. You may ask why, because it is an area where the corporates are not really using for their own financing needs. It is dominantly dominated by the financing institutions, especially banks. And currently, the total debt capital market stocks, 55% is by the banks. And actually, only for the, when you look at the issuance size, 67% are the banks. And when you look at the corporates, they are not really using the capital markets very actively. This was even more true when you go back to 2011. Just to give you a number, in 2011, corporates were only having 9.2 billion TL bond stock in their financing sources. And currently, this has been evolved, and now it's five times bigger. This has now reached to 47.6 billion TL. In dollar terms, it is only $13.5 billion. Can you imagine, in a $900 billion economy, corporates are only getting $13.5 billion from the capital markets? This is by far too low compared even with the CEMEA region when you compare. That's why we have selected supporting the capital market developments as one of the very key themes for Turkey, which I can talk more later on.
Thank you very much, Ali. Very helpful. One of the underlining supports for any well-developed capital markets is the quality of people and the quality of human capital that's available in that market. We have Paul Smith from the CFA Institute. He's the global president. CFA Institute supports the development of human capital globally. Maybe Paul can share a little bit about what's happening on that front, and especially with respect to Turkey as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Hasan. Good afternoon, everybody. It's great to be here. One of the world's great cities. It's always a huge pleasure to be here. Thank you. I'm probably, as you can hear, I'm English, although the CFA Institute is an American organization, and even more strangely than that, I'm actually based in Hong Kong. And I think that gives you an indication. The first thing I want to say is that as an institute, we're a very global organization. I'm very proud to say that we have charter holders in over 155 countries worldwide, which is more countries than McDonald's has franchises in. So I think it's a wonderful global footprint. We have over 300,000 young people sitting our exams at any one point in time, and about 142,000 charter holders in the world, of which about 66,000, just to give you an idea, are in America. So very thinly spread when you come outside of America. And here in Turkey, a country of great size, we have only a handful of hundred of charter holders. So we have a long, long way to go. Global penetration rates are less than 10% in terms of people who look after other people's money, fiduciaries responsible for other people's money. Less than 10% of them have the CFA charter, which is probably recognized as being the premium qualification for investment managers. It's not to say that lots of other people involved in the asset management industry don't have qualifications. Obviously, they do of varying sorts, but a lot don't. And I think we're very fond as an industry of referring ourselves or referring to ourselves as a profession. And the thought that I would leave you with is that the professions that we all recognize, like doctors, for instance, it's not optional to have a credential. When you go to a doctor's surgery, the first thing you see is her or his certificate hanging on the wall. In the investment business, that's not the case. The vast bulk of people in the investment business are unqualified. And when you think about what it is that we do and one of the underlying problems that we've discussed, I think that's a real issue for Turkey and for lots of other countries around the world. You know, we take people who've got, in theory, lots and lots of money, but very few investment ideas. And we as professionals have a lot of investment ideas, but regrettably, in many cases, very little money. And the idea is that we match those two constituents. We take the money and the ideas, we put them together, and hopefully we create an investment system that works. And that has to be built upon trust. And trust is founded around, yes, competence and ethics, which we certainly teach, but trust is really built around the concept of professionalism. That first, second, and last, when you are engaged in that transaction, you are thinking about what your client needs above all else. And that is sorely lacking in our profession today. And all of the surveys out there demonstrate that, that financial services professionals are ranked just a notch above journalists in terms of our trust quotient. And that's dreadful for an industry that is founded upon trying to match money with ideas. Nick mentioned, I think, that regulation is set to increase in the world. We think that very definitely is going to happen. Regulators are politicians at the end of the day, and they respond to what the public think. And where you have this lack of trust, regulation is sure to follow. And a lot of the work, a lot of the thought leadership work we do as a professional body is trying to think forward 10 years as to what this industry might look like. And we've done a couple of reports that I draw your attention to, one called The Future State of the Investment Profession, and the other one called Purpose, Habits, and Incentives. And it seems to us that our industry is drifting into irrelevance, that we have yet to really prove to the public what the purpose of investment is. And I think Governor Anwar and Şule have spoken about the need for infrastructure investment. And when you think about what the public think about investment professionals, they see us as very self-centered. They see us as primarily playing in the public markets. They see a lot of activity being professional to professional, and very little of that activity actually creating value for the communities and the societies that we serve. And I think as an industry, we need to think through that very much more carefully, how we prove, how we speak about the value that we offer to society, rather than constantly talking about quarter over quarter public fund performance. We need to talk in terms of long-term solutions that the investment industry provides to the communities that we serve, and infrastructure investing, building that, that base that allows countries to move forward is very definitely part of it. Well over half our candidates are in the emerging world. It won't surprise you to know India and China are our biggest markets. And it's very, very apparent that this is what those countries need more than anything else. The absence of a functioning financial services industry is the single biggest issue that holds countries back. I think we need as industry participants to think very much more carefully about how we can articulate the value that we bring to society and then really walk that talk in everything that we do.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Now we can have a bit more of an interactive discussion. There are a couple of themes that have emerged from the presentations today. And I'd encourage everybody to have a say as well. Just to be a little bit provocative in a sense, one issue that kept coming up is the issue of trust. So, for example, Ünlü has been around for a number of decades in Turkey. There are trusted relationships, there are trusted advisors to companies. Trust in regulators is also as critical.
Given what's happened globally, and I think each one of you may have a slightly different perspective, what can be done within Turkey, for example, to expand that that relationship? Would you like to start?
Okay. I think Paul also touched on criticism for the central banks, my colleague here touched on about the debt that is prevalent in Turkey. And they've touched on something very important. And what I'm going to say is not intended to frighten anybody, but to give you an example, where the trust in the international monetary system was shaken after the global financial crisis has really plagued everybody, all financial institutions in investing in long term, which is necessary for foreign direct investment and so forth to create an enabling environment for inclusive growth. That has not been happening. Now, that restoration of that trust in the international monetary system is in the hands of the central banks. And they must spearhead this particular campaign to restore that public trust. Now, there are a couple of ratios that I like to point out, and it's a fact. Today, the household and corporate debt in the global economy is about 138% to GDP. In 2007, it was 115%. In the developed economies, it's 195%. Now, how has that been created? It's because, obviously, the low interest rate environment. Flight to capital, flight to safety, and yield. The 10-year bonds currently at 2.3% in the dollars is attractive in many instances. Now, look what happened with tapering in 2013 in the summer. Turkey depreciated by 21% its currency. India by 17%. Argentina, Brazil, Sri Lanka, all these countries were hit because of, again, flight to safety and to yield. The central banks need to be a bit more coordinated and a bit more cognizant in terms of managing the monetary policy. The moment you see a hike in the interest rates going up now, what's going to happen? It might create a little catalyst. I say the word little, but I talk about the subprime business, which wasn't the case. It was these quants who created these opaque products called derivatives, which I never understood, and I don't think anybody did. And subprime was simply the catalyst that broke that bubble. It was really a mispricing of risk assets is what caused this whole crisis. Now, if hikes and interest rates go up now, again, in any major fashion, you're going to have problems. How are you going to service that debt that we were talking about? That is going to create a problem for the world. So this is where opportunities come up for banks like Ünlü and other investment bank advisors. I mentioned earlier about infrastructure, that $50 billion is allocated, but only $1 billion is allocated from $50 billion because it's not bankable. Why? Because long-term assets in these global financial crises with banks, the project finance divisions got decimated. So the expertise is lost. Some banks are restoring that, but it's a long way to go with the Basel Accords, how Citibanks, JP Morgan's, and others are somewhat reticent in building up that long-term book because it impairs ratings as well for them, and that creates a cost of capital, a cost of borrowing going up. So that's where we need to focus a bit more in having investment banks with expertise provide the advisory service and have the resources to raise capital not only from within Turkey, because Turkey is an excellent market, it has developed capital markets, and project that expertise in markets, emerging markets, where there isn't that kind of expertise. And that kind of combination can help Turkey be a leader in the emerging markets area.
Yeah, I was just going to say on that I think you make a good point, Hasan, that it's not just about the professionals that need to be trusted, it's the regulators as well. And just deflecting away from central banks for a second to security markets regulators, I think it often strikes me that security market regulators have two main functions. One is to stimulate growth, and the other is to control market participants. And I think all too often in the developing world, the challenge for security markets regulators is they err on number two and not on number one. When I think about China, the regulator there is very focused on, first and foremost, growing the capital markets and improving China's financial position, and less worried, balance-wise, about controlling participants. Unfortunately, that's not the case in many, many emerging markets around the world, that the regulator, I think under this pressure of global best practice, really has erred on the side of control as opposed to growth. So I would certainly leave that with any securities market regulators in the audience that you should think about growth first, control second. Inevitably there will be issues, inevitably there will be bad actors, and those you have to sort out. The other thing that I would say to your trust comment is that what the market needs is trust in regulation. And the market above all else needs players who are free from interference, independent in the way that they're able to express their views, and confident that regulators are not going to be an arm of politicians that will extend into the capital market sphere to prevent independent commentary from being made that may well be critical to the government of the time. And I think all too often in emerging markets, again, that is a trust challenge that we have, where government interference in security market regulation inevitably leads to a diminution of foreign capital's interest in that right. Country.
Paul, you'd like to share something on that?
Yeah, well, now that Governor Anwar and Paul have sorted out the regulators, I'd like to take it down to the level of individual banking institutions, because I don't know what it's like in Turkey, but certainly in the UK, the word banker has become effectively a swear word after the financial crisis. And that is because many banking institutions behaved towards their clients in a pretty shabby way, frankly, in a poor way. There was overcharging, there was too much complexity. People were sold things that they didn't understand what it was they were buying. There was definitely amongst the commercial banking institutions a tendency not to put the client first, but to put the client somewhere at the back of the queue. That has changed, and it's undoubtedly the case that balance sheets have shrunk, that banks are simplifying what they are doing, and that's all good. And it will take time before trust is renewed, but at some point it will come back. It is still the case in the UK, even after everything that's happened, that you are much more likely statistically to get divorced than you are to change your bank. Even after everything that's happened. But people still don't trust their banks. But what it means is, as I was saying earlier, as this pendulum of regulation has swung, and as banks have, if you like, self-regulated back to being more like utilities and less like these sort of entrepreneurial complex organizations, that has created a hole for financing. And that's where it's really important that there are other alternatives, whether that be equity financing or whatever. And I would just say that whilst the central banks have focused on goods price inflation, one of the big problems is that asset price inflation has been enormous. And that's created a lot of inequality and a lot of political issues, many of which are coming back to bite us now.
Lastly, I will just take the whole thing towards Turkey. Yeah. Having the experience of 23 years in the banking market, as well as the 7 years in the multilateral organization side, I think although all of you somehow criticize the regulators, I need to thank here our Turkish regulators actually. Because they were really very open and to hear views, ideas and solutions. And they really were listening to us and taking every necessary actions in order to support our initiatives in a way. Of course, this is at the end their own objectives as well, to achieve their own regulatory duties, but they were always very supportive. They were always very open. They were always very eager to take every necessary action, even sometimes it was difficult and hard pill to swallow. And that was our experience in Turkey, and that's helped, if you ask me, to come make the Turkey come to this level of development today. For trust, if you ask me, there are two very important things. One of them is consistency, and the other one is transparency. And until now, what we have experienced in Turkey, at least when it comes to regulators, they were always very consistent. And once there were certain steps taken, this continued for the improvement rather than going backward. While in some other countries, we have experienced that some of those regulations has been put upside down and everything was changed for the worse, which was making the trust to such countries loosen. While that was not what we experienced in Turkey, and that's actually one of the questions which we always receive, for example, when it comes to energy market. And one of the questions we receive, what happens if Turkish government stops supporting, or when it comes to PPP hospital projects? We are hearing some questions coming whether Minister of Health will change his strategy. We didn't experience this. When it comes to privatizations or when it comes to any kind of concession-based infrastructure project, when there was a problem there might be problems, and the good thing we experienced with the Turkish regulators and authorities, when there's a problem, they sit down with us or with the relevant parties and try to come up with the solution so that the project can survive. So another very important thing is transparency. I need to thank the Capital Market Board here. They are really supporting us when it comes to our capital market initiatives. One of the things which we are really trying to achieve is to improve the disclosure requirements for the debt capital markets, because that will help the institutional investors and international investors to come to this market with more pockets, basically. Great. That's probably very briefly what I can mention.
I think it's very good to know, because it is a regional financial center. It is going to be a regional financial center, so it's very encouraging to see that the regulators have that proactive perspective in a sense. I want to shift the discussion. We've got just a few more minutes left, but the relationship between Turkey and the Belt Road Initiative that China has, this is a very long-term relationship where the financial intermediaries would be quite a useful part of it. How does Turkey fit into the bigger picture, and how, many of you may benefit from it? I think that's something we can touch upon before we close the session. Can I see?
Just before I answer that, I want to give a caveat that I was a regulator for only 7 years. The rest of my career was private sector. Okay. The Belt Road Initiative, the most talked about initiative, can be enormously beneficial to many countries. There are challenges, there are winners and losers that will come about. But it's a program that provides the resources and focuses on the one area that I've mentioned earlier, and my colleagues did too, is the engine of growth for the global economy, that's infrastructure. Infrastructure has its risks. There are three phases to it. The planning phase, which is the riskiest, where the private equity comes in. There's the construction phase, where financing for other long-term investors can come in. And the final stage, which is the operational phase, where commercial banks can come in. It's the easiest portion. Now, that's where investment banks can come in to play. The expertise, as I mentioned, has been decimated. And there are suppliers to these projects with the Belt Road Initiative tied in. Just to give you an example, in 2016, General Electric generated $2.3 billion in additional orders and equipment compared to the year before. It's all related to BRI initiative. Caterpillar is up 49% in stock price. And since 2013, it's been in positive trajectory in its stock price, where prior to that was below it, all related to BRI. So you've got American companies, ABB, Deutsche Bank, and others, Honeywell, are all benefiting from this. So it's not restricted only to China. Turkish companies, American companies, and other companies around the world can benefit from this if they have the proper knowledge and expertise to latch onto this. That's where investment banks, especially banks like Ünlü, can come into play. And that's very, very important. There are many, many complex scenarios which will be challenging because the legal environment, the social, cultural. Take Central Asian republics, the China trade link to England, which was started about a year ago. The railway gauge in China is different from that in Kazakhstan. So you've got to change the containers onto another track. These are kind of things that will be overcome, but many countries like Turkey, Iran, and Pakistan, in fact, are working very actively in this particular program. The Turkish alliance with the Central Asian republics and China is very strong. China and Turkey have signed a currency swap agreement.
Okay.
That allows benefits for trade to be denominated in local currency. That eliminates the risk associated with hedging currencies for importers and exporters. So that's an opportunity that should be utilized. Granted, the Chinese currency RMB was not recognized earlier, but as of last year, it has almost 11% weightage and is an acceptable reserve currency. And central banks have started allocating reserves in that particular currency.
Okay.
So that's an opportunity also for participating banks to tap into.
Quick remarks.
Okay. Well, the only thing I can say is for the position of Turkey. I mean, Turkey has been always a bridge between the two continents. And I think in this Belt Road Initiative, that role will be even more enhanced because, I mean, we are on the way of the Silk Road anyway. One of the things which we think that now Turkey needs to prioritize to support this initiative is we need to focus more on our railway infrastructure because that's an area which was until now probably it was not yet priority because unfortunately the Turkey agenda for the infrastructure is really heavy. But going forward, we are thinking that focus and prioritization of the railway to support this initiative will be very key.
Paul, do you have any views since you live in Hong Kong and have a bird's eye view of things?
Not on that particular, I agree with everything you said. I just want to throw out green finance
yes.
Just as a quick comment. I know Nick has chosen Ünlü for their equity expertise rather than their bond market expertise, but I think that's an enormous capital markets developments issue that all financial players need to think about. Whether China can deliver on its sustainability goals for the Belt Road Initiative or not, I would question, but at least they're talking the right way about it. 40% of all green finance bonds issued worldwide, I think, now come from China. That's a remarkable effort and one that we certainly support them in. I think the general investment banking world should be very supportive of as well.
Excellent. We have come to the end of our session. The hour goes through fast, actually, quite quickly. I'd like to thank our panelists and Mehmet earlier for the introduction. We are around. If you have any questions, we'd be happy to talk to you in the coffee area as well. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Let us kindly host Mr. Talal Abu Ghazali in the stage to present the plaques to our panelists. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. And Mr. Smith? Thank you. And now you can enjoy your lunch. Many thanks for your attention.